Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How are we doing this morning?
Great.
All right. Good to be back together again. If you're visiting with us, we're glad that you're here. Just want to welcome you to services here at Lane Christian Church. And if you are visiting with us, just want to draw your attention to the bulletin that you picked up when you came in the door. On the edge of that's a little perforated flap. We call it the connection card. If you wouldn't mind filling that out for us, just so we can have a record of your attendance here with us this morning, and drop it in the offering plate, which is just to the left of the door out here. And if you are visiting with us, that's the only thing we want you to put in the plate, because we view this time together as our gift to you. Of course, on the back side of that, something there for everybody. It is a place of prayer request. Make a praying church. We'd love to have the opportunity to pray with you, to pray for you. So you put your prayer request there. It's also a great place for updates. Helps us keep our prayer list current and up to date as well. Now, as far as announcements go this morning, I have a few of them. I just want to say thank you to everybody. We had a busy weekend here at Lane Christian Church. A lot of stuff kind of got piled on a single weekend. Had a garage sale out here. Thank you to everybody who came out and helped with that, set stuff up, donated stuff. I haven't got a total for that yet. Hopefully we'll have that for you next week. And then also the youth group did a cookout this weekend at IGA. And we brought in, I don't know what the total is going to be after all the bills are paid, but probably somewhere around $2,000. So thank you for that. That will help send our kids to CIY this summer. And believe it or not, it snuck up on us. Mother's Day is Sunday. It's early this year. So every Mother's Day, at least we can do it again. We have breakfast here. There's no Sunday school next week, and there will be no youth group next week either. We get together at 8:30 for breakfast down here in the gym. I was told the tables are already set up, so we don't even have to set up the tables after church. But what I will need is after church is over, guys, we cook for the ladies, and then in June, the ladies cook for the guys. And so we're going to need to get together to get this stuff planned out. So if you could help us with Mother's Day breakfast, we would appreciate it. We're going to have a little powwow up here by the piano as soon as church is over to get that figured out for what exactly we're going to be doing for Sunday. Now, before that, on Saturday night, everybody knows who's been on our prayer list that Ray Smith fell on the ice and broke his leg and has banged himself up pretty good. He's still in rehab. And his insurance is not being nice to him, go figure. And so they are going to have a benefit here from 5 to 7 on Saturday night to raise money to help cover his medical expenses. And so just encourage everybody to come out for that, take part in it, and support him. He's been a part of our church for a long time, helping our kids' ministry, and so anything that we can do to support him would be great. Those are the announcements that I have for this morning. Anybody have any others? Yeah, April.
We're having a bazaar meeting on Tuesday at 7 p.m. out in the gathering area.
Okay. All right. So if you are helping with the bazaar, which is in October, right?
October the 29th,
out in the gathering area Tuesday night. Anybody else? Yeah, Ed.
Just because we like to buy a lot. Area men's this month is Tuesday night at Little Galilee, and it is ladies' night.
Yeah, we're doing ladies' night again. The only thing they ask on that is, and it starts at 6:30, that if you are going to go, please RSVP. That way they know how many they're going to be cooking for, since it's not just the guys this time. Anybody else? Yeah, Mitchie.
Well, our slides didn't make it today for some reason, but anyway, we are looking for people to help us planning the celebration for the mortgage burning.
Yep.
So we need, we've got a picture of like the first service, so all of you are in there. There's a lot of you still here, so please come join us, and that is Wednesday, what is it?
18th,
I think that's the right date.
May 18th?
Yeah.
Yeah. I couldn't remember what we said. So yeah, Wednesday, May 18th. All right. Anybody else? All right. Praise team, you can have it.
gospel and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all of our sins, who heals all of our diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his way to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. It kind of blows your mind, doesn't it? As far as the east from the west, as far as the heavens above the earth, he is great. He is a great God. Let's sing praises to him.
Oh, Lord, our God, when I God gave David the victory over a huge problem named Goliath. And yet we can see from Psalm 40 that David also had problems in his later years as he prays, "Oh Lord, don't hold back your tender mercies from me. My only hope is in your love and faithfulness. Otherwise I perish, for problems far too big for me to solve are piled higher than my head." The problem of not wanting problems is not always obvious. You see, going without problems is a sure way to draw away from God. If we don't have problems, we won't even think about God. We don't even have a life on our own, and we don't need God at all. I have to give up the illusion that I deserve a problem-free life and that there should be a resolution to all my difficulties. I cannot fix everything, and the one thing I cannot fix is my sin, which probably has caused all my problems to come. God calls us to live in constant prayer and communion with Him, even in the midst of this problem-filled world. He doesn't tell us that in this world we might have trouble. He says that we will. We are challenged to relinquish the fantasy of a problem-free life and accept each day as it comes, finding God in the midst of our circumstances, even thanking Him for the hard times. A successful day is not one where our problems are all solved, but one in which we stay in constant contact with the one who is in control of all things. When we look at the life of Jesus, we see that He had problems at every turn, but He kept in touch with His Father and stayed the course. On the cross, Jesus died to overcome the problem of sin. May we remember and honor Him today as we partake of this communion. Let's pray. Father, our world is challenging, to say the least, but we forget that Jesus faced difficult challenges also. Coming to earth and walking here as a human, leaving heaven on our behalf. How would we live our days if we knew a cross and horrible cruelty were waiting for us? Only Jesus could do what He did. We are extremely grateful for the price Jesus paid for us to save us from our sin problem and our separation from You. We thank You for this opportunity to partake in these emblems and to remember the sacrifice made for us by Jesus. It's in His name we pray.
Before I do that, I've got a correction. It's May the 11th, Wednesday, May the 11th at 7 p.m. for the meeting. So please come and join us in planning this wonderful celebration event. Yes. Praise God. That's one praise we can start with today. Another, Rodney thanks everyone for their continued prayers. Nikki Sturgeon's ready to come home.
She is home.
She is home, all right. That is really good. Then Marty Vincent had the lung capacity to do the heart surgery that he needed. It wasn't going to be a stent. It wound up being bypass. Anybody know? Yes.
He ended up having a quadruple bypass, and came through, and everything's good, and hopefully they'll let him come home either Tuesday or Wednesday.
Awesome. All right. And as Pastor Tim mentioned, we have Thanksgiving for our garage sale success and for the youth group making money for CIY. I think that's awesome. And for all the people that are bringing the mortgage down, that's a praise. Our beautiful day, even though it isn't that windy, and it looks like it's going to continue to rain for a while, but that's fine. The longer spring lasts, the less hot it gets. That's just how I look at it. All right. Anyone else have praises? Yes. Benny is doing great and appreciating everyone contacting him, but as Roger said, the nursing homes need help with the COVID influx. It has been really hard for people to get over that. Anyone else? All right. Debbie Pettigo, I was told this morning, we are praying that she can get into Mayo Clinic. That's going to be an opportunity for her to get over the struggles that she has had. And her white blood count is going up and need to find out what's going on. This one just comfort for Stacy and Steve Craig and losing Lillian. That really broke me when I heard that. Marty Vincent was transferred to Springfield, and as we have heard, gets to come home Monday or Tuesday. So that's a celebration. Heidi Huddleston, she's been diagnosed with breast cancer. Renee Isaac gives us Johnny Newberg, who's also been diagnosed with cancer and her lungs. There's just so many. Lemoyne, Ross, and his wife and sister all have health issues. Guy Griffin, Al, how's he doing? Where are
you? Last we heard he's supposed to go back in June, and they're still reevaluating what drugs he can handle.
But he is doing better.
He's doing better, yes.
Thank you. You've got a nice, clear voice. You can hear it. it's surprising how you can. That's all right. You know, I don't need a mic. I could really be heard down the hall. I lost my temper one time with my class. They were messing around.
It was probably my class.
That probably was.
It wasn't me, though.
No, it was him. They locked the door on me. I came in and boy. That never happened again, I'm telling you. Everybody in the school heard me go off. And it was like, you should have seen. Fear of God came down in my classroom. we have lots and lots of prayer going up for people. who have had issues. Has anyone heard anything about Cindy and how she's doing since Mayo? Yes. And who passed?
Carl Mitchell.
He passed.
Yes.
So it's for his family.
Yes.
All right. Any others? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Sweet Heavenly Father, we just give you praise. And I want to thank you for bending down and listening to our prayers. Thank you for giving us this covenant opportunity to intercede for others, for our brothers and sisters in Christ, for those who are in pain and loss of sorrow, for the Mitchell family, and for the Craig family. We thank you, Father God, for comfort, for peace, Jehovah Shalom. And we thank you, Lord, for healing, Jehovah God, for all of these that we have mentioned. There are so many on our prayer list, far too many. And we're just one church in one community in our country. You see everyone. You see their struggles. You see their challenges. You see their agonies, their frustrations, their anger, their depression, their fear. But Lord, you are the God of hope, of restoration. Jehovah Mekadesh, you are our righteousness. You are the one that goes before and gives us victory, Jehovah Nisi. We thank you, Lord, that we can rely upon you, roll all of our cares upon you because you care for us. And we thank you, Lord, for this church community and how we pull together to support each other. Thank you for filling all of the needs that this church has. Thank you, Father God, for a pastor who looks to you every day of his life for guidance and who leads his sheep with compassion and faith. We thank you, Father God, for each one here and for those even at home, that they would come to know you in a new, fresh, and glorious way. And we just rejoice. We rejoice in this day, the first day of May, May Day, that we will celebrate with more than just flowers and baskets, that we will celebrate the resurrection of a living God. And it is your precious name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Started here. Get your Bibles out and open up to Colossians chapter 4, which is where we're going to pick up. And hopefully my tablet decided that it was going to reset itself. And so I want to begin with, Bethany, if you can go ahead and give me the next picture up here. I want to start off with this. This has been the backdrop of our sermon series as we made our way through Colossians. Is everybody familiar with the story? What it is?
Yeah, we saw the play.
Yeah, and if you have been to Branson and you have seen Jesus, this is the picture. Now, I will tell you, it's from one of the most amazing faith stories found in the gospel. Jesus calls Peter out of the boat to walk on the water, and he answers the call, yet the storm causes him to struggle with his faith, and he sinks beneath the waves like the stone that he is. Jesus reaches out to save him. It's a powerful picture, both physically and spiritually. Sometimes we're like that in our lives. You know, we read the story in Matthew 14, and I think sometimes we're tempted to get down on Peter. Oh yeah, there's Peter. Guy can't keep his eyes on Jesus, and he sank like a rock. Well, last I checked, he's the only one that's ever walked on water outside of Jesus. You know, we can Monday morning quarterback it all we want, but at least give the guy the credit he deserves for trying. I also chose it because sometimes we're doing what we've been called to do, that is to tell the world about Jesus, acting as evangelists and disciple makers. We can often feel like Peter on that storm-tossed sea, bombarded by the winds and waves of culture, and maybe even worse than that, our own self-doubts and our abilities. Yet in the midst of it all, Jesus is there to pull us out of the depths and to set us back on the paths of our calling, to set us back in the direction that we need to go, restoring and reinforcing not only our relationship with him, but his call in our lives. Now, up to this point in our text, and we're coming down to the very end of the book of Colossians. We'll be there this week, and next week we're going to wrap it up. The vast majority of Paul's instruction at this point has been focused on living under the lordship of the all-sufficient Christ within the community of faith. It's all about relationships. But at this juncture, he shifts gears a little bit, moving the focus from life within the body to the growth and expansion of the body. So you've had this inward focus up to this point, dealing with issues, the false teachers, things of that nature. And now Paul shifts gears and says, okay, now we need to focus for a specific amount of time here on what you're supposed to be doing going out. As you go out, as you live life, we realize, or at least we should realize, that being a Christian isn't just about going to church on Sundays. Yeah, we're supposed to gather together, and Scripture tells us that we're not supposed to, neglect the assembling together of believers and being part of that assembly, but that real life happens beyond these doors. That evangelism happens beyond these doors. When we lived out in Idaho, the church I served out there, as you walked out the doors of the sanctuary, up above those doors, I would put it here, but we've got an exit sign there, is simply the statement, you are now entering your mission field. That is what we are called to do. We're called not only to maintain biblical truth and foster health within the body, we're called to actively participate in God's redemptive plan. That is, if you want to call it his scheme of redemption, for the world. Jesus can save the world, but he has chosen to have us help him do it. Now, I will put this out there. We have the ability to save absolutely no one. But what we do have the ability to do, and the requirement to do if you're a follower of Jesus, is to point people towards him. Go ahead and give me the next slide up here, because this thing is going to reset. Key thought for the morning as we get into it. The supreme task of the church is the evangelization and discipleship of the world. I usually put that statement out there, that the supreme task of the church is the evangelization of the world. But then as you dig into it, you study Scripture, and you look at it, you come to realize, as I talked about in the very first message of this new year, that discipleship and evangelism are two sides of the same coin. You cannot have one without the other. You can't have discipleship without evangelism, and you can't have evangelism without discipleship. And so we put them together, and we work them together. So how do we get into this? Here in Colossians chapter 4, this is one of the oddities of Scripture. If you notice, you were with us last week. We read chapter 4, verse 1. I have no idea why they broke the chapters where they did. You do realize that the verse indicators and the chapter indicators were later additions that when these letters were written, they weren't written book, chapter, and verse. They were just letters, and so they came along and they added chapters and verses just to help make it easier for us. And why they broke it, where they did, I will never know. Because actually, chapter 4 should start where we're actually going to start at today, which is verse 2. So we're going to read verse 2 and 3. Paul here writing, continually steadfast in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on the account of which I am in prison. Go ahead and give us the next slide up here. And so what we're looking at here in this, in this second to last section, the second to last pericope of Scripture, is this idea of ministry opportunities. Opportunities to share the gospel, what they are, when they are, and how we as individuals, and also as a body, are supposed to use them. Paul begins and ends his letter with an emphasis on prayer. In the former, we see him modeling prayer on behalf of the Colossians that they might know and fulfill their purposes. Here at the end, he invites them to join him in praying, interceding for others on a missional level. That is this, that God would open doors for him to share the gospel, and that God would open the door for them to share the gospel. This isn't a request about him personally, you know, help me get through this. No, because he's in prison, but for evangelistic opportunities. He's less concerned about his own personal misfortune and physical needs than he is about the gospel. His focus is on the word and its reception by those around him, because it goes through a door that only God can open. Let me rephrase that, restate that. It goes through a door that only God can open. We have a message to take. That message is clear, the gospel. Jesus died to save sinners. We have opportunities given to us, and they are given to us directly by God. I love the terminology divine appointment to describe them. That God makes these appointments for us, and it's up to us to be on the lookout for them, to be able to engage people at appropriate times. So God is the one that opens those doors. The metaphor of the open door is used often in the New Testament to describe opportunities for evangelistic outreach. Luke uses it in reference to Paul and Barnabas. Acts chapter 14, page 923, if you happen to be following along with one of the sanctuary Bibles. Acts chapter 14, verse 27. And when they had arrived and gathered the church together, they declared all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. So Paul and Barnabas are out running around the world. They're preaching Jesus. And as they're going out, God is giving them opportunities. Now, I think it's interesting that sometimes those opportunities come in pleasant situations. And sometimes those opportunities come in not so pleasant situations. In the midst of our trials, in the midst of our tribulations. And the fact is, we don't have to force conversations, intimidate people, or try to coerce them into believing. And in fact, such actions are wholly counterproductive. Anybody ever here ever have the opportunity to hear a street preacher? Someone standing on the sidewalk preaching, or I guess I should say more often than not, yelling. Kim and I were down in San Antonio here a couple of years ago, and we went to the Alamo because, hey, when you're in San Antonio, you go to the Alamo. And we are across the street from the Alamo, and there is a gentleman there on the sidewalk, and he is literally yelling at people about Jesus. And I watched him for a few minutes because I'm a people watcher. And then I told Kim, I said, if I ever do that, Slap me. I mean, in all seriousness, how many people are you going to convince that way? I've said it in here multiple times. Nobody likes a jerk for Jesus. And this guy was the poster child of jerk for Jesus. We can't downplay sin. Sin is real. We can't downplay our human faults, our human frailties, and that we need Jesus to fix them. But walking up to somebody and yelling at them, spitting in their face, I didn't get too close to this guy because I didn't want to shower about this. I often wonder how productive he was. Now, can somebody be convinced that way? Oh, I'm sure it's a possibility, but I don't think it's very probable. Oh, sit down. Have a cup of coffee. Let's talk about Jesus. See, when we look at Scripture, even the end of the Bible, the book of Revelation, you know, we read the book of Revelation, and what comes to our mind are all these end times things of what's going to go on, one world government, all this. You know what the book of Revelation is actually about? It's a book of hope. It's a conversation directed at us that we need to build bigger tables to invite people in to tell them about Jesus. That's how we share the gospel. So we pray that God will open our hearts, this done to advance the gospel. As Paul takes us through here, we get into chapter 4, the personal pronouns change. They change from us to I. So it becomes personal, if you will. Expresses a reflective awareness in Paul's heart that he viewed in the circumstances of his imprisonment through the lens of the gospel. So he's sitting there, he's in prison, he's in chains, and how does he look at it? Does he get down about it? No. Was it comfortable? Absolutely not, because of course in the first century if you're in prison, it's not 3 square meals a day and cable television like it is today. You're in chains, you're in a hole, and if your buddies don't come and take care of you, you starve. So Paul's in prison, but he's not complaining about it, because he views all that happens in his life through the lens of the gospel. Paul talks about it in different places, about the things that he's experienced, the number of times that he's been shipwrecked, the number of times that he's been beaten, the number of times that he's been mistreated, all of the above. And does he complain about it? No. Oh, I'm sure there were times that it frustrated him. I'm sure there are times that it made him not feel good. But look what happens with him and Silas when they're in prison. I'm sure the other prisoners must have thought they had totally gone off the rocker. They're bound hand and foot in chains. And what are they doing? Singing praises to God? You all are nuts. You need to be praying that God gets you out of here. I think Paul and Silas had some background information that those in prison with them didn't. That God was going to do something amazing there. And that's exactly what happened. He views the circumstances of his imprisonment, in fact, all of his life, through this lens of the gospel. Paul even tells the church in Philippi that the gospel was advanced by his imprisonment. He viewed it not as an obstacle to overcome, but an opportunity to be engaged and exploited. Let's use every opportunity that we have to be able to tell people about Jesus. Philippians chapter 1, verses 12 through 14. Here he's talking about the advancement of the gospel, page 980 if you're following along in the Sanctuary Bible. He said, I want you to know, brothers, what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. So here we look at Paul's life as an example. If Paul can do this while he's in prison, what does that say about me when I'm just living life? When I'm just going to work, when I'm just going to school, when I'm just doing my thing, day in, day out, with any real trials or tribulations. If Paul can do it in prison, then I sure as heck should be able to do it wherever I happen to be. Because when you look at it, not only was the gospel the cause of his imprisonment, but his imprisonment also became a platform for the cause of the gospel. So it goes from being because of the gospel that he's in prison to being in prison for the advancement of the gospel. Man, if we can only all view our lives that way. And so that is the call to prayer. To pray for witnessing opportunities. To be able to have those times where we can share Jesus with people. Do we pray for those opportunities? Rhetorical question, but answer it in your own head. Do we seriously pray for those opportunities? Because, hey, some of us are introverts. Some of us are extroverts. We want to be around everybody. We want to know everybody, but some of us aren't. We all have our struggles personality-wise, and we're afraid of things. We're afraid of our own inability. We're also afraid of rejection, aren't we? What's going to happen if I share Jesus with this person? Especially if it's a family member who happens to not know Jesus. I mean, look at it. How many of us have family members that don't know Jesus? Every last one of us. Get together for a family gathering. Do we pray that God would give us the opportunity to share Jesus with them? Or do we hope that it doesn't come up? What are the two things that divides families that you should never talk about at family gatherings? Religion and politics. Well, not talking about religion and politics has made it almost virtually impossible for us to talk about religion and politics. Focal point here on the religion. We need to have those conversations as uncomfortable as they can be, and we have to pray that God opens the doors to allow us to have it. A.T. Pierson, generation ago, the great Presbyterian missiologist, go ahead and put the next slide up on the screen, says this about it. God has no greater controversy with people than this, that with boundless promises to believing prayer, there are so few who actually give themselves to this type of intercession. Do we pray for those opportunities? We read in the Gospels that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. I wonder why the workers are few. That explained to me this way on one occasion. The workers are few because the church has become allergic to wheat, and it's a self-imposed allergy. We don't do it because we don't want to do it. We need to want to do it. And how do we get to the point where we want to do it? Take that first step to do it. Oh man, it can be frightening. It can be scary. And will you be rejected? Perhaps. But no more than anybody else that's gone before you. But I think you'll also find that as it happens and as you do it, you become more comfortable with it. And any discomfort that's there is actually healthy for you. For me. For all of us. See, God gives us not only the chance to share the gospel, he gives us the choice. We have an option to share the gospel, but since we have that calling on our lives, is that option really an option? Last week I talked about judgment just a little bit, what it's going to mean for us to stand before God in judgment. And then we will answer to God for those things that we have done that we shouldn't have done. But then we also answer to God for those things that we didn't do, that we know we should have done. Do we take it seriously? I've said it here on a couple of different occasions. Penn Jillette is my favorite atheist. Everybody know who Penn Jillette is? The illusionist, Penn and Teller. They have a show in Vegas. Penn Jillette makes no bones about being an atheist. But he also says this, kind of calling Christians on the carpet. He says, if you honestly and truly believe in eternal life, how much do you have to hate me not to tell me about it? He said, if you truly believe it, I expect you to try to convince me of it. How much do you have to hate me to not tell me about it? I heard him say that, and it's kind of like, ooh. You know, that stinks a little bit. That burns a little bit when you get called out by an atheist about not being evangelists. So how do we do it? Well, here it is. Here's the application. Go ahead and give us the next slide up here. In light of our own salvation, we must pray that God would give us witnessing opportunities and the burden to act on them. Now, are we going to miss them? Sure we are. Have I missed witnessing opportunities? Oh, I'm sure, more than I could ever count. But a lot of times you see them after the fact. Oh, well, I could have done this here, I could have done that there. Now, well, don't get so caught up on beating yourself up over it. But what it is like, okay, God, give me the willingness and the tenacity and the willpower, which we'll talk about here in just a second, to do what I need to do. The next time the opportunity becomes available. So it leads us to the next thing. Next slide up here, please. To pray for the wisdom in those opportunities that we are given. Verses 4 and 5, going back to our Colossians passage, we read this. That I may make it clear, which is how I ought, which is how I ought to speak, walking in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of the time that is available. Paul's request for intercession on behalf of his evangelistic efforts invites the Colossians to be involved in the global mission of Christ, starting at home and expanding around the world. Isn't that the way we do it here at Lake? We start at home. And then we go around the world. You look at our missions wall out here in the hallway, which it needs to be updated. We update it from time to time. But we also send out the emails when they come in. Some of our ministries are right down the road. Little Galilee's 5 miles down the road. Neighborhood Care Center is 5 miles down the road. And then we've got my nephew Travis and wife Becky there in Japan. We support Matt and Cindy. As soon as we get her headache issues taken care of and they get back to Senegal, they're in Senegal. So we go out from here. We may be planted here. This is our mission field. But it starts here and it expands around the world. I find it interesting that when Jesus gives the Great Commission, go therefore into all the world, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and I'm with you always, even until the end of the age. There's some things that we lose in translation. One of the things that we lose is this is not an ordered list that you start here and you have to finish here before you go to the next one, before you go to the next one. It's literally as you are going. So if you're here, you evangelize here. But if you walk over here, you evangelize over here. And the discipleship, that part of teaching them all that I've commanded you, that's the discipleship part of it that we are called to do. See, Paul, when he asked for their prayers, he never intended their involvement to just be peripheral, engaging only in prayer. You know, we need to pray. In fact, we shouldn't do anything as a church without praying first. You know, we talk about our identity, who we are, ordinary people helping each other become faithful followers of Jesus. We talk about our mission, engaging those who think people is irrelevant. Who think God is irrelevant, encourage them as Jesus transforms their lives. The vision, believe it, grow it, send it, that's the gospel. You know, everything that we do connects to those. But we don't do anything in regard to any of those until we pray. But we can't stop at the prayer. We have to put feet behind it. We have to be willing to take the step out to engage. So his request also involves active cultural engagement through the missional efforts of the church, both corporately, but here more specifically as individuals. His admonition to avoid false teachers can easily be used as a license to avoid non-believers and to retreat from the forward advancement of the gospel. Monasteries have always intrigued me. Ever been there? The monastic life, you shut yourself off from the world, you study the Bible, a life of quiet prayer and contemplation. I've always found it fascinating, but you know, I also find it equally frustrating. We are called to live in the world. We are called to be separate from the world. But we are not called to separate ourselves from the world. You know, Jesus sat down and he ate with sinners. He ate with lawyers. He ate with prostitutes. Jesus hung out with bad people. But did you miss the part about the fact we're all bad people? But listen to this. Jesus hung out with those people to influence them, not the other way around. He was there to be not only a cultural influencer, but a spiritual influencer, more importantly. And so that's exactly what he did. Here many years ago, C.S. Lewis made the observation, if you want to change the world, go sit in the smoking section. I think there's not many smoking sections left, but you get the picture, don't you? You have to go sit in places that you wouldn't normally go. Several years ago, there was a Bible college student that got expelled from college. Why? Because he was seen walking into a bar. That gets you in trouble. But why was he walking into the bar? To meet up with somebody that he'd met a few days prior. This was a place that individual apparently felt comfortable. I'm going to meet you on your own turf. And that's exactly what he did. How many of us get hung up on the fact that people sin differently than we do? How many of us get hung up on the fact that there are places that we don't like to go? Sometimes those places that we don't like to go are exactly the places that we need to be going. Now we have to take care of ourselves spiritually and not be influenced by that which we encounter, but to be an influence on that which we encounter. And Paul talks about it. He says he makes their mission responsibility clear by addressing how they should engage what he refers to as outsiders. This is a general reference. It shows up again in 1 Corinthians 5. Outsiders, those who are not believers. He's not talking about the false teachers that the church has been dealing with. No, he's talking about those that aren't Christians. Those people which you should actively engage. You need to engage the false teachers that are teaching bad stuff and help set them right. But as importantly, if not more importantly, the mission of the church remains that you've got to continue to tell people about Jesus. So, what does he bring up? Being wise in speech. This is to be clear and concise in the language that we use. This means we must speak in such a way that remains faithful to the text of Scripture, while at the same time considering the context of the audience. How many of you have ever tried to learn a foreign language? I remember taking foreign language in high school. I tried to take German. I didn't do very well with it. In fact, I've learned more German since I left high school than when I was in. In fact, I joke around with people that when I took German in high school, the only thing we accomplished was learning the words that you were never supposed to say in public. But we can lose stuff in translation. Going from one language to another, it makes it difficult. There are Bible translators scattered all over the world that struggle to take the original Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic of Scripture and put it in a language that people can understand. Sometimes, coming up with the first form of a written language that's never been written before. Imagine the challenge. And then look at the life that we lead when we're talking with people that speak the same as us. And we still have challenges, don't we? To try to take what we read in Scripture and to run it through our heads, which could be a dangerous place, and then have it come out our mouths in such a way that they can understand it. And also taking their culture into consideration. Look at the book of Acts. Acts chapter 17. This is page 926. Paul is in Athens. Starting with verse 22. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship is unknown. This day I proclaim to you." Paul was a Jew. He was a Pharisee, which means that he was a student of the Torah. He was a student of the law. He knew it forwards, backwards, inside and out. But was he talking to Jews? No, he was talking to Greeks. So what does he do? Well, when you read further on down there in Acts 17, he quotes their poets and their philosophers to point them to Jesus. He didn't change his message. The message was still, Jesus died to save sinners, he was buried, and he was raised from the dead. And they thought he was really nuts on the raised from the dead part, because they had this idea, you know, spirit's good, body's bad. Had some trouble getting past that one. But he spoke to them in their context. See, when we're sharing the gospel with people, we must steer clear of social, political, and personal issues that would muddy the water. That is, we are to go out and meet them where they are with what they need, and to do it in a language that they can understand. I remember when I was in Laos on my internship, sitting down with a man that I had spent the entire summer building a relationship with, praying for those open doors to be able to share. He lived in an animistic culture, spiritualistic animism, where you have different spirits and a whole lot of other stuff. And so when you're trying to explain God, try to explain God to a person who worships multiple gods, and try to explain the Trinity without getting him confused. I realized that after 3 years of Bible college, I was way out of my league. And after I left that conversation, and the one after it, and the one after that, the three that we got to have, my prayer was simply this: God, help him remember what he was supposed to hear and forget the parts where I messed up. Sometimes that happens to all of us. Sometimes it is God sanctify the words that come out of my mouth before they do. That what I say brings honor and glory to you. And then translate that into evangelism and discipleship. Allow my words that are your words to return fruitful. And we know the word of God, sharper than any two-edged sword, and that it will never return void. Most of the time, my prayer is, especially when I get up here to preach, God, please help me to get out of the way. I enjoy preaching, I enjoy teaching, but my greatest prayer on Sunday morning, whether I'm teaching a Sunday school class or whether I'm preaching a sermon, is that you don't see me, because it's not about me. Never has been, never will be. So let's look down at verse 6 there. "Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each person." There are people out there who love to pick fights with Christians. I mean, they're out there, a dime a dozen. You can find 100 channels on YouTube of people picking fights with Christians. The problem is that sometimes we're gullible or stupid enough to try to respond to those. I learned a long time ago, theological discussions are like political discussions on Facebook. They don't work, and you're not going to change anybody's mind. Now, I like face-to-face interactions. They're fun. But you have to have the right motives in mind. Are you there as iron sharpening iron? Are you there as somebody who has honest questions, seeking an honest result? I'll have those type of conversations all day long. But I refuse to wallow in the mud with people that just want to pick fights. Now, mind you, there are those that sometimes start out wanting to pick fights that come around and go, "Okay, maybe I need to look at this." And that's when you make that transition of, okay, we're pulling ourselves out of the mud now. Let's start having the hard conversations, because those conversations oftentimes are hard. So conscious of our surroundings. You know, Paul's conscious of his surroundings. He was actively aware that cultures are openly hostile to the gospel. It was the same as it is today. Back in that day, the Romans hated Christians. Romans considered Christians atheists because they didn't worship the pantheon of gods, and they refused to worship the emperor. Just the weird thing about the Romans were really inclusive. They allowed you to have religious and spiritual freedom as long as you worshiped everything. The Christians refused to do it, and so they became the enemy. He's calling on us to act with wisdom in regard to outsiders, that is, our lifestyle pattern, our lifestyle platform. That is, it must be seasoned with salt to be effective, to make the gospel palatable. We don't have to make it relevant. It's already relevant by its nature. Go ahead and give us the application up here on this one. In light of our salvation, we must pray that God would give us wisdom in our opportunities so we can make the best of it. Again, this is Dear Jesus. Please help me not be a jerk for Jesus. And then the last thing here, as we move down towards the end, is simply this. Pray for the willpower in all opportunities. This goes back to the last verses that we read. We've already gone through our entire text here, verses 2 through 6. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer one another. So this gives us the praying for willpower in all opportunities. Now, is being a Christian about willpower? No. But it is. It's praying that God would give us the determination to do what we know that we need to do, to give us the strength. It's not about us acting under our own power. If we think that we can do this, if we think that we can live the Christian life under our own power, that we think that we can evangelize and disciple others under our own power, we're nuts. I can't even hardly get out of bed under my own power some days, let alone change the world. Only Jesus can do that. Only he can give us the power and tenacity. In fact, Paul says it. When I am weak, I am strong. Not because of me, not because of anything that I do, but because of what Christ is doing in me as God continues to transform us through Christ. Paul makes it clear both directly and by context that the world will always hate Christ and will always hate Christians. Jesus says the same for each one of us. Go to the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 24, verse 9. He makes it pretty clear. Jesus talking about the end of the world here, what the signs of it will be. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and will put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations by my name, for my name's sake. Not by some, but by all. Political government hates Jesus. Oh, they may try to co-opt Jesus and use Jesus for their own ends. But the political sphere and the spiritual sphere do not get along. Engaging in evangelism and discipleship isn't easy, but it must be done. It's easy to get discouraged, but if we do it the right way, we'll win the war, even if we lose a battle every now and then. Well, we may get rejected. Someone may look at us and go, yep, not interested. Back in Acts, where we were just at, Paul's in Athens, and he's talking to the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers. Some of them believed. But some of them looked at him and went, dude, we love philosophy, but you're nuts. And walked away. But see, here's what it gets down to. We cannot be argumentative. We must present the message. We can compel people, but ultimately we can't convince them. We can contend for the gospel, but we ultimately cannot convict. That's Jesus' role. That is the role of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings conviction, not us. We share the message, and we can't be ashamed of that message. Somebody looks at you, are you a Christian? You know, we started out today with Peter walking on the water, and he struggled. But we also know that that's not the only time Peter struggled, did he? Hey, aren't you one of Jesus' followers? No, I ain't one of his followers. Yes, you are. Are you one of his followers? No, I'm not. Hey, aren't you one of his followers? And then he reverts into the foul-mouthed fisherman mode. Literally, I swear to you, woman, I don't know the man. If we looked at it in the original text, I mean, he is trying to distance himself from Jesus as much as he can. He is ashamed at that moment. He has not only lost his walk, he's lost his talk. But we also see that he comes back. He repents, he's convicted of what he's done, and he comes back. Our testimony is our life, and it must show the gospel. The testimony of our lips must share the gospel. There must be a walk behind our talk. We don't just preach the word, we live the word. And so here's the application for it. In light of our own salvation, we must pray that God would give us the willpower in our opportunities so we can walk our talk. The talk's got to be there, but the walk has got to match it. And so here is the takeaway. Praise team, if you want to go ahead and come back up. It's simply this. Evangelism and discipleships are not programs of the church. They are the lifeblood of the church. They are the reason for her existence. The church exists for evangelism. The church exists for discipleship. Oswald J. Smith was one of Billy Graham's teachers. Premier missiologist. Made this observation once. A church that does not take seriously the winning of souls has forfeited its biblical right to exist. Wow. How harsh is that? If we don't take seriously the supreme task of the church, the evangelism and discipleship of the world, we forfeited our right to exist as the church. When you reflect on your life, who you are, where you come from, and where you're going, there's only two options. Either you're going to follow Jesus or you're not going to follow Jesus. So we come down to our two questions, the ones we ask every week, because this is all about Jesus. Today we've talked about the second question. Last week we focused more on the first question. This week we focused more on the second question. What do you know of Jesus? First question, salvation. Have you accepted him as your Lord and Savior? If you haven't, that's the most important question you can ask, the most important question you can answer. And then the second one, then what are you going to do with Jesus? You're going to keep him to yourself? You're going to share him with the world? That's it, guys. And next week, we wrap up by looking at some people who did use what God gave them, the opportunities that Jesus gave for the first question and for that second question. But at the end, man, we can read the story all we want. We can know the end of the story. But until we make it personal and we're willing to do something about it on both fronts, we have not lived life. And we do not view Jesus as sufficient. So if there's any needs this morning, anything whatsoever, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
Thank you.
together. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're so glad that you're here and hope this morning has been a blessing to you as your presence here has been a blessing to us. Just a reminder, next week's Mother's Day, come on out, 8:30, have breakfast with us, and then we will gather together again for worship. Go ahead, reach out, grab hands with people next to you, and we will ask God's blessing on our week. Let's pray. Dearly Father, Lord God, we just thank you for this time that we've had together here this morning. Just to praise, to worship, to study from your word. To know that you are there, that you are all sufficient, that you are there to guide us, direct us, and also to pull us out when we're drowning. To set our feet back on the path that we need to be on, both in our own personal lives, but also in the lives that we lead, to point others to you. We thank you for those opportunities. We pray for them to have the opportunities to share you with others, those divine appointments. Lord, just ask that you would give us one or maybe more this week, that we would use them, that you would speak through us as you work in us, that we can point people to you. We thank you for the blessings of life, but most importantly for your son, Jesus, and it's his powerful name we pray all these things. Amen. All right. Guys, if you can help with breakfast, we're going to meet up here by the piano and get stuff figured out.